we had a preview with an artist from Argentina who was crossing through Berkeley early in September, but this is the beginning of our weekly program. The rules of the games are very simple. First of all, my name is Francesco Spanello. I'm the curator of the Magnes Collection. Welcome, everybody. And the rules of the game are that we bring together speakers, both from campus and the community, and objects from the Magnes Collection, and see what the sparks are, and learn about the multidisciplinary way of looking at the Magnes Collection, one of the largest Jewish museum collections in the world. So week after week, we bring out more objects from the collection and more brain power from our broad community. It's my pleasure to host today Noa Bar Gabai, who's a doctoral candidate at UCLA. Her work is on Orientalism and Hebrew literature, and she will be speaking up around this topic, but in connection with objects that we selected together from the Magnes Collection that depict this trope of Oriental type. And as you can see in painting, in an etching, and you're welcome after the talk, maybe not during the talk, to come close and look at the objects, of course, but also carved on a seashell. So we looked across different types of media to research this type, and Noa, her title today is Shelling Out, thinking about also the commodification of the Oriental type on a souvenir like a seashell. So I encourage you to welcome Noa, and this program is made possible also in partnership with the Jewish Federation of the East Bay, our upstairs neighbors who fund our refreshments and make sure that you have coffee or tea and a snack for with us. Enjoy and welcome Noa.
And then I said, Jessica, so I actually was hoping that you would come take a look at these artifacts during the presentation. So if everyone could actually just come up and take a look, because otherwise, you know, what's the point? You can't see. And then we'll do some heavy theoretical lifting a little later. But so these are the three objects that the talk is about. This is really, I think, the highlight. It's a shelf. And I'll go, you know, into greater detail about all these objects, but this one is attributed to Boris Schatz. It was not made by Boris Schatz. Now, Boris Schatz is the founder of Bezalel, which is the art school in Israel, and it was founded in 1906. This is, we'll get, I guess, into more detail later, but there's no signature or imprint on this, right? So we know that it's made to be a circulated object rather than a fine art object. I mean, it's like a very fabulous piece of porous pitch and very intricate. And then we have, speaking of the Orientalist types, this is an etching by Hermann Struck, and I'll get a little bit more into Struck's biography. This was made in, I believe, 1922, right after Struck immigrates from Germany to Palestine. And then we have this painting by an Orientalist painter, Maurice Bismuth, who was a Jewish pied noir, meaning he was born in Tunisia. This is of a rabbi in Jerba. And so they are, as Francesco said, three examples of Orientalist types and Orientalist art. So we're going to talk more about what that is.
Do you have any idea about the date
of the shell? The shell is dated between, I think, 1921 and 1929.
And Julie, correct me if I'm wrong on that, but, or did she do it?
Yeah, so I think it was made in the 20s. These are all 1920s after I was staying. Sure. Let me just adjust this. I don't know why it's like not showing everything. Maybe because it's, if I zoom it out, it'll.
If you put it up in under view, I think you do it as
The title that I was given when I did this is Examples of Orientalism in Israeli Culture. So why did I change the title of the talk? The main reason was that if we're talking about this as Israeli culture, we have obviously the slight issue of period, right? We can't really speak about Israeli culture as such until after 1948. But it's not really only for reasons of period that I say Palestine. By Palestine, I mean Jewish Palestine. Because I think that when we talk about Israeli culture, we're talking about a sort of unity, right? A unity of the territory of the Holy Land with the Hebrew language and the Jewish religion in some form. This kind of cohesive totality that forms Israeli culture. And I think when we're talking about pre-state Jewish Palestine, we're talking about a dynamic and troubling sometimes process of the formation of this thing called Israeli culture. And that's why I'm using Palestine in the talk rather than Israel, which was the original in the talk. So we'll also talk about what this secularized relic is and try to understand this seashell that's up there as an example of the secularized relic. And of course, that comes from the writings of Walter Benjamin. And Walter Benjamin was a literary theorist, among other things. And he, in his writings on the French poet Charles Baudelaire, wrote about the souvenir as a secularized relic. He said the souvenir, which in German is das Andenken, is the secularized relic. The souvenir is the complement of the experience, das Erlebnisse. In it, the increasing self-alienation of the person who inventories his past as dead possession is distilled. The relic derives from the corpse, the souvenir from the deceased or defunct experience, Erfahrung, in the German I think it's the gestorbene Erfahrung, dead experience, which calls itself euphemistically Erlebnis. So there's a lot to unpack in this quote, but it's the idea that, you know, we think of the souvenir maybe as something that reminds us of a happy time, and Walter Benjamin says, no, it's actually about death. We're killing experience, right, by making these souvenirs. And I think also that the secularization is very relevant to the Jewish-Palestinian context, because as we'll see, we have these sort of cultural visionaries who are trying to secularize religious difference as a kind of national culture that's developing. That in that way, they are also sort of deadening certain things that are right next to them and certain people who are in their midst. So the first thing that I wanted to talk about was this etching by Hermann Struck. Hermann Struck is famous for this portrait of Theodor Herzl. Show of hands if this is familiar to anyone. Okay, it's in every kind of Zionist Congress brochure. I think I read that in the the 1910s and 1920s in Palestine, every office had this profile of Herzl in it. Struck was a German Jew. He actually, at one point in his early life, wanted to be a rabbi. He studied Talmud daily. And he was part of Mizrahi. Not to be confused with Mizrahi Jews of today, but Mizrahi was a proto-Zionist organization which was advocated for Orthodox Judaism and the Orthodox point of view in the Zionist movement. And in some ways, the movement was opposed to cultural Zionism that we would associate with someone like a Hada'am, but actually Struck didn't see any kind of conflict in contributing to the culture of the issue of pre-state Palestine and his belief in orthodoxy. So he was an etcher. I don't know if one can be an etcher. He made etchings. So this etching, and you know, I'm a literary scholar, not an art historian, but from what I understand, an etching is a copper plate, and so it's made in the negative. And I think it's probably very difficult. So that's my technical analysis. And so this is very intricate. It's a profile. This, as Francesco mentioned, is what we call a Jewish type. So this Jewish type, and in talking, of course, about the circulation of these images, we have something from North Africa, and these were made in Palestine. But we also, this image actually also comes from Europe. So what Schluck is also famous for, in addition to this portrait, is the illustrations for a book that he did with the writer Arnold Zweig called Das Ostjüdische Antlitz, or The Face of European Jewry. So this is also Schluck. Again, we have a figure in profile. So here, this volume showed all of these Eastern European types. And there's a kind of fascination here. And we'll discuss Orientalism in just a little bit. But Orientalism certainly has to do with a certain gaze that is fascinated by an exoticism of another. And so there is a kind of Orientalism happening with Western Jews towards the Ostjuden, the Eastern European Jews, that kind of had to do with two things. One of them was this idea of their exoticism, of someone like this man with his beard, with his expression that looks, somewhat sort of forlorn and vacant. And just the way that we have his profile on display, very similar to the profile of this, this is called Portrait of an Arab, right? When we're putting people in profile, there's an almost like Lavaterian phrenological interest in their features. So this in some ways represents exoticism, right? The Eastern Jew is to be understood as the exotic other, the living embodiment of authentic primal impulses. And there's a conveying a kind of Eastern Jewish simplicity and a pre-modern harmony of its lifestyle. So this is done really right before Schluck goes to Palestine. He's, an assimilated Jew who in some way, but is still religious, but also probably looking towards the East to try to understand himself and his milieu, not in a bourgeois way, but actually what is an authentic depiction of a Jew. The other thing that was happening in Europe at this time is the debates around the Jewish question. This is another photo from the book with Zweig. And so there were a lot of debates over what to do with the Ostjuden, and there was a lot of depictions of them as primitive, degenerate, lacking any kind of culture, right? And so we can see in this also a kind of attempt to correct those stereotypes, a kind of recuperation of the Eastern European Jew through these types, right? As something, as humanizing them, basically. So there's both that kind of gaze of the other as exotic and authentic, and also a need to sort of defend these Eastern European brethren, right? And we have, here's the young kind of yeshiva buffer, schoolboy, the older man, probably like a peddler or something. So they're types, right? And we have here maybe another peddler. This is also from the book. So Schluck did these right before he did this one in Palestine. And again, people in profile, maybe a sense of exoticism. So these are all examples, as we said, of Orientalist art. Orientalism comes from Edward Said, and we have kind of, from what I can tell, a very nice hybrid audience. And I see some academics who are probably intimately familiar with this, and people from the general audience who may or may not be. But anyway, I think it always helps to have a little review. So the concept of Orientalism, as it's talked about today, comes from the book Orientalism, which was written in 1979 by the late scholar Edward Said. And so Said showed how the West, and we'll get to this quote in a little bit, I know it's kind of a handful, but he looked at how largely the French and Spanish imperial powers beginning in the late 18th century were all of a sudden in proximity to Asia and Africa and the Middle East, and very much fashioned their ideas of the East, of the Orient, as a kind of internal Western construct that had to do with seeing that the space of the Orient as a screen onto which to project fantasies. So they construct a representation as a reflection and an invention of the Orient as a means of constructing their own identity as a Western imperial power. And it's one that can be surveilled and managed. So Said is borrowing here from Foucault's idea of discourse, from the idea that knowledge is not simply a set of facts that we can wipe away or change at will, but knowledge actually constructs subjectivity. And so it's not, right, a mere political subject matter. This is not too small for people to read. It's not a field, and this is a direct quote from the introduction to Orientalism. It is not a mere political subject matter or field that is reflected passively by culture, scholarship, or institutions, nor is it Orientalism, that is, a large and diffuse collection of texts about the Orient, nor is it representative and expressive of some nefarious, quote, Western imperialist plot to hold down, quote, Oriental world. It is rather a whole series of, quote, interests, which, by such means as scholarly discovery, philological reconstruction, psychological analysis, landscape and sociological description, Orientalism not only creates, but also maintains. It is, rather than expresses, a certain will or intention to understand, in some cases, to control, manipulate, even to incorporate what is a manifestly different or alternative and novel world. So basically, what he's getting at is, again, that this is a diffuse network of ideas that create something, right? They're not dry subjects. Rather, the image of the Orient, or the Orient is one that's created and maintained. And moreover, it has less to do with the Orient than it does with, quote, our world, right? So I mentioned earlier the sort of process of collective identity formation, we could call it, that was happening in Jewish Palestine. And that's certainly relevant here. Now, of course, Jewish Orientalism is a bit different, very different, than the kind of Orientalism that's associated with imperial powers. It is different for many reasons, but one of which was the very sort of ambivalent position, an ambiguous position of Jews vis-a-vis Europe, right? So Jews are really both the subjects and the objects of the Oriental gaze. They were the objects of it long before they were the subjects of it, which is very important to remember. Hebrew Revival. That was in many ways, right, the attempt to create this native Jewish culture in Palestine. And before we even talk about that, right, we do have to remember, again, that ambiguous position. So Jews were the subject of the Orientalist gaze, as I said, in many ways. Biblical Jews served as the basis for Christian depiction of Muslims in many novels and many travelogues. When we read colonial discourse of missionaries, they often drew upon the figure of the Jew to characterize an encounter with any kind of exotic, faraway people that they didn't know, right? And in that sense, that was a Jewish type, I think, for Western powers. And there's also a lot of drawing upon this trope of the lost tribes of Israel in the accounts. So when we talk about Orientalism in literature, there are three authors who are really associated with Hebrew Orientalism. There are Moshe Smilansky, the father of Esti Zahar, David Frischman, and Yaron Peled is the literary scholar who's written most about them. They all wrote between, I think, 1915 and 1930. So there was a way in which all of their writing incorporated elements of the figure of the Arab to produce a sense of the Jew as rooted to the land. So when Smilansky describes Herzl's one and only visit to Palestine in 1899, he writes about all of he is himself on horseback and he's with his peers on horseback and they come to greet him and there are Sephardi Jews who come to greet him and they praise him in Arabic as the Messiah. So we have already in that sort of literary tableau this this sense of the rugged, like almost cowboy, or like you can think of an Arab who riding a horse, which is replacing this image of that kind of Ostjuden type of the sort of bookish Jew or the poor peddler, right? We have this like rugged Jew on horseback. And that was a big trope in Hebrew Orientalism. And so both the images of, and this is most likely Palestinian Arab, it's just called Portrait of an Arab, but this was very much part of the construction of the identity of what we call the Yudia Hadash, the new Jew. And there is a kind of ambivalence or ambiguity of the Jewish gaze towards the figure of the Arab in the sense that there's simultaneously an identification and a distancing. And we'll see that in some sense with all of these artifacts. But there's a way in which there is an identification with almost what we today would call a positive stereotype, maybe, of someone rooted to the land, part of nature, and also seemingly, I don't know if it's necessarily here that I would say that he looks rooted in nature, but very often in the literature, that's the idea of having a native kind of knowledge, that's part of what the figure of the new Jew, the construction of that figure sort of borrowed from. And at the same time, there was a need to distance and to distinguish and to say, we are here in the Middle East, but we're very much a European culture, right? One of the goals of this ideology of the negation of exile was to establish the Jewish state as a normal state, normalization, an idea that the existence of the diaspora was defective and uncreative, and that a new European-style culture could actually only happen in Palestine. So there was also a distancing, right, of being modern. And in a sense, I think we can see that maybe through his positioning, right, as like a just almost scientific, not active in any way. There's not like any kind of suggestion to the viewer of interaction. We're just like purely looking at a profile. So that is the etching. And let's see, this is on modernist types. We basically covered that. Then we have this painting. This is called Old Man with Prayer Book by Maurice Bismuth, who is a Pied Noir. He was born in Tunisia. And we see here, if you want to come up and look at it, feel free again. There's a background, I couldn't figure out if this was like a Ner Tamid, but it might be, you know, the flame that's always lit in the synagogue. And I couldn't find a lot of information on bismuth, but I did find an article on this website called googlebooks.com, and this is from The Advocate, which is, I believe it's out of Boston. I don't know if it's still in print, but it's one of the oldest Jewish journals, I guess, in the U.S. And again, right on the subject of this idea, this image, or Jewish type, or an Arab type, a Jewish Arab type, of its circulation, right? Here we have, we can see the similarities here, right, of a Tunisian, French Tunisian painter painting a Tunisian rabbi, written about in an American newspaper. So if we want to continue that theme of the circulation of this type, here it is in Boston, reporting on the French president's visit at the time, Mitterrand, to Djerba. And so it says that, I don't know if it's a little blurry, but he basically came and visits the great synagogue in Tunis. At the entrance, more than 150 old rabbis standing in a row waited for the president, who, on entering the synagogue, was presented with bouquets adorned with tricolored ribbons. The girls were clad in biblical robes and wore brilliant jewels. The president was greatly moved by the reception. So he's really interacting, right? He's meeting the rabbis, the girls in jewels. He enters the part of the synagogue where the scrolls of the law, the Torah scrolls, are kept. He bows to them reverently. He asked many questions, which were answered by the chief rabbi and translated to him. So he's speaking through a translator, through the chief rabbi of Djerba, again, very much engaging. The president asked the rabbis to conduct divine service during his presence, and this was done with much ceremony. They put on a good show for the French president. Blessings were offered for Madame Mitterrand and heard with great reverence. During the visit, the president also visited Salon Tunisien, where there was an exhibition of paintings. Madame Mitterrand walked through the room in which were hung the pictures of Monsieur Maurice Bismuth, a Jewish painter who showed a number of representations of rabbis in prayer and synagogue interiors. The president congratulated Monsieur Bismuth on his work. So we don't know that the French president saw this painting, but it seems very possible that he did. And the thing that strikes me about this little write-up is just that contrast. Between the French president going to the synagogue, meeting these 150 rabbis, watching the service, asking questions through a translator, and interacting with the Jews of Tunisia, and then he goes to a salon to see, presumably, paintings of these Jews who he's just met and spoken to. So it's really kind of confounding, and thinking back to that Benjaminian idea of the secularized relic, of the idea that a souvenir is something that, even though it's meant to remind you of experience, actually deadens that experience, right, in the need to keep it alive in some very fixed way. I mean, what is more of like a relic? It's simultaneously dead, except that this guy's probably still alive. So it's just a very like funny, again, that relationship of like closeness but complete distance, or that viewing him as also very much in the past, right? It's actually called Old Man with Prayer Book. So again, he is in the past, even though he's also very much in the present, meeting the French president. Then we have the shell, and if everyone could just like come and look at it one more time, since it's so small and so wonderful, you can't even see from there. I think we were discussing it as a possible honorarium. Is that right? Yeah, he's nodding. So yeah, this is really the prize item for me here. circulation of this Jewish, this Arab Jewish type. And he is most likely a Yemeni Jew. He's writing, right? Just like here we have a prayer book. And again, it's like this funny pastiche of past and present, because it's a conch shell, right? So, and it's, I would even associate this with like the Caribbean or something, right? It's like, again, with the normalization idea of like, I went on vacation, I went to Aruba, I went to Palestine, I got this shell. Very much like about leisure. And then there's this marked contrast with actually the subject, who again looks, you know, has peyote sidewalks, is writing, looks very like ancient. And so this was made in the workshops of Bezalel, the Israeli art school, or I guess I should say the Jewish Palestinian art school, to stay true to period. And again, with this notion of Jewish types that we saw with the depictions of the Oz student, that notion is just imported to Jewish Palestine. There's a scholar named Dalia Manor who wrote a book about Bezalel and the art of this period. She says that pictures of local Jewish types, almost always of Oriental origin, were particularly important as part of the effort to create the genuine art of Palestine. These Jews were the most visually attractive to Western artists in Jewish Palestine, and depicting their images was considered a fulfillment of Bezalel's aspiration to create a Jewish art that draws on the land of Israel. So again, it's the idea of authenticity and using that authenticity to secure and suggest an authentic relationship to territory, to the land of Israel, and also the creation of a culture that was to counter Western European stereotypes and also Jewish self-stereotypes that there could be no creative Jewish culture. Bezalel really had, at its founding, she writes two principal primary missions that often conflicted. So one of them was the creation of this culture. The other one was economic. It was to provide craftspeople with jobs. And we see here depicted a Yemenite Jew. Yemenite Jews were silversmiths at Bezalel. It was a very common occupation. In I think around 1908, they opened their silver department, and Boris Schatz, who founded the Arts and Crafts School, tried to even bring Yemenite craftsmen from Sana'a, Yemen, and he made in Ben Shemin an artist's colony devoted to Yemenite silversmiths. And so that is also very curious that they were kind of producing the artifacts, but they're also, like, there's a certain romanticized image of the Yemenite Jew on the artifact as well. And so, in thinking about this idea again of the secularized relic, where we began, I also wanted to think about why talking about these artifacts is different than talking about literature, since I mainly write about literature. And the answer I came up with has to do again with this circulation of the secularized relic. So these were obviously meant to travel, right? It's a tourist item, it's kitsch. And I think that when we talk about written narratives, the big difference is that you can't make art in Hebrew, right? You write Hebrew narratives, you can only write them in Hebrew. And so by very virtue of their medium, they're doing two things. When we're talking about Hebrew authors in Palestine in the 20s, we're again talking about this effort to create an authentic Jewish culture, but it did not have a lot of readers at this time in the 1920s. Right, so it was about imagining a native readership as well. And in that sense, it was in group, right? Not only like do you not have your group of readers, you're trying to imagine them, and by virtue of your very medium, you're creating Hebrew culture that's meant to stay within the place, and that's meant to be rooted to the place, and that is a very much a programmatic collective effort to write Hebrew literature that's of that place. Now with artifacts, we have a medium that that doesn't in and of itself convey that. Maybe a conch shell makes you think of the sea, but I don't necessarily, I see it and I think of like the tropics, I think of somewhere warmer. So there's almost a funny displacement that's happening, and something that's not about this kind of rootedness, but an effort to maybe circulate this secularized relic. As we've seen, it's an idea that came from Europe to Palestine through that ambivalent Jewish Orientalist gaze, eventually gets reported on in America. And so in that sense, I think that the Orientalist art of the pre-state period does do something very different than the literature, right, in the sense that we have an idea that travels. So that's what I have to say, and I look forward to your questions. James?
Normalized or commercial.
Yeah. Yeah.
You come across that in representations of Oriental Jews by Jews.
Like a kind of idealization.
Or the shift from, maybe they really were a higher strata at one point, but then increased immigration.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, I don't know if this is directly answered to your question, but there certainly were Jews native to Palestine, and they spoke Arabic, they had lived there for centuries, and then there was definitely a move after the British gained control of Palestine to sort of curry favor with the colonial power, and there was a very deliberate push in Zionism to push out, I think Eliyahu Eliyahar was the main Sephardic representative, and he was a politician and was very much at the helm of the Zionist movement, and then was very much marginalized. So certainly there was, I can't necessarily speak to the aristocracy part, but I think very much part of the region, and were at some point like poised for leadership, and then no longer. And certainly that's part of just the Western orientation of free state Palestine, a Jewish Palestine in Israel as well. Francesco.
Yes. Again, thank you.
My pleasure.
And this whole line of connections around Orientalism also inserts itself on an earlier German, Jewish, and European debate on the Orientalism of the heritage of Moorish Spain.
Oh, okay.
So what we see, you did a great job in connecting literature to visual culture, but we also see it in architecture. We see it throughout Europe in the development of Moorish-style synagogue architecture across Europe since the 1830s, 1840s. And the reference is both to the Bible, so the idea of Moorish, Arabic, Middle Eastern culture as a way to better understand the Bible, but also to Moorish Spain as an ideal moment of cohabitation among cultures, the whole idea of convivencia.
Mm-hmm.
And we also see the music, the Ashkenazi German Jewish community of Hamburg, again in the 1830s, erases its music, its Ashkenazi music, and instead imports Sephardic Portuguese music as a sign of Orientalism and a form of like added authenticity. So the idea of Orientalism of authenticity is probably the link then to the movement to Palestine, and so there is an agenda of Jewish authenticity that also fights against the prejudice against Jews lacking style, lacking art, lacking aesthetics, etc. So these are all the topics you're so wonderfully playing with. I don't know how much you thought about moving beyond text and visual text into the realm of space and architecture or music, but there are
things. I'll call you up.
I'm back.
Walter, but I don't know if you're familiar with Walter Benjamin in general, but his kind of, I think, most famous critique has to do with the loss of the aura, and the idea that even in this quote, when he's talking about the souvenir as deadening, I think he quite literally means that the souvenir comes from the relic, which was, you know, we use relic as like it's something that's old, but I think he really, like they used to save like skulls of like saints and things, right? And that was the relic. So when he says the souvenir is the secularized relic, he's also sort of drawing this genealogy from these like bones and clothing to souvenirs. And so he famously critiques the loss of the aura in his piece, The Work of Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction, and talks about how art objects originally were part of a cult, had a cult status in ancient times, where there was an encounter of an almost spiritual aura that was contextualized within the experience of the cult. And with mechanical reproduction, and now, you know, with the internet, which is like mechanical reproduction on steroids, or whatever the kids take now, right, it's like you have this loss of the aura. You no longer have an original encounter. It's no longer contextualized in this spiritual environment, and it's no longer new.
But you think you have.
Exactly. Yeah, and you when you see it, you see your thoughts about it, right? Or like, Benjamin writes about like the Mona Lisa and how there's a line, I think that's Benjamin, that there's a line to go see it, and then no one's seeing it for the first time. So you've already seen it. Definitely that idea of like this deadening of the aura is kind of at play here, and when we look at photos all the time. I mean, you all saw this, right, before you saw this. And that's just how it works now. You know, things circulate for better or worse. And I also don't know, and I don't think that Benjamin necessarily laments this loss of the aura, because I think he saw in it a great democratic potential, which I think is also true of cell phones. So certainly we lose the original encounter with something new. At the same time, how many people got to be in those cults, right? And like how many people can, so it's not necessarily something to lament, I guess, but I know what you mean. Other questions? Okay, thank you so much.
With our programming every Wednesday at noon, we have very interesting talks.